I have the happy announcement of Prahlad Kakkar. 2 minutes away, he's on his way to IDC, he's at the gate. And the reason why it's a big deal is because it's very difficult to get Prahlad Kakkar, and he's actually, made the time. These are, he's a media guy. This is Prahlad Kakkar. A big hand for the man.
This is a Sindhi club, which is not funny, right?
No. It's not a funny thing to say. It's not a compliment, right? Okay, so he's just come from a wine tasting affair, and he's drinking water to dilute the wine so that he gets to do his stuff well. Prahlad is ad man par excellence, and we'll get David to do all the French. And he is wedded to he's physically wedded to a woman, mentally wedded to many, prepared to do even more. He is wedded to his he's wedded to his profession, which he makes his profession look like a breeze. And today, when there was a lot of stuff on the screen that talked about Coca-Cola taking over the world, you need to know that Prahlad is the face of Pepsi in the country, where he gets these fancy cricketers and movie stars to come and, it's like getting Brad Pitt and Brian Lara to do the ads, so he does these films. Prahlad does all the Pepsi films, all the Shah Rukh Khan, Sachin Tendulkar films have been done by Prahlad, and many more. He's a man with amongst his numerous passions, he's a man with a passion for cigars, for single malt, for hats.
Single women.
They are afraid of you. They are putting up their hands.
Of course not.
hats. So if you want to give a gift to Prahlad, it's got to be a hat. And there's a poster in his beautiful food. He's a foodie. He says every day when we get to work, the first thing they discuss is what are we going to have for lunch. They set the menu, the food starts cooking in the kitchen, and then the day's food work starts. And there's a poster in his office, beautiful office, which has Godfather in his hat. Prahlad, tell them about the poster. It replaces Godfather, Marlon Brando with
somebody's Prahlad. Copied the Godfather poster and put my mug on it, basically.
And you can miss it, you think it's actually Marlon Brando. I mean, but the Prahlad Kakkar is Marlon Brando.
Office is fun because I think it's both.
You've got it.
I think the office is fun because if you don't have any work. Most of the time when you don't have any work, then everybody's very morose. When we don't have work, then we cook, we drink, make wine, invite people, do all kinds of things. And everybody has to work very hard, because I think cooking is very hard. People have to chop, clean, somebody has to order them around, etc. And at the end of it, if the food doesn't turn out well, then somebody has to get all the galis.
So, galis means four letter words.
And but I think at the end of it, we end up eating quite well, because as you can see, from the last time, I have put on weight. And so we've been experimenting with olive oil, because somebody decided to make me the ambassador for olive oil for the International Council of Olive Oil Countries.
Wow.
So now we get large amounts of olive oil from Spain, and we don't know what to do with it, so we eat it.
Prahlad has been a great ambassador, a great supporter of design. I cannot tell you how he's a very, 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 he's really pressed for time, but whenever we've wanted to meet him for ideas, he makes the time very happily, very graciously. He's also a very, very big champion of sustainability because, and that's the part he's going to tell you about, the Lakshadweep.
Well, in 1998, we got our, 1998 was very significant because we were talking about global warming. And we were talking about global warming as some distant thing that happened to other people, or might happen to other people, or a whole bunch of scientist types who wanted to get freebies from various funds were talking about global warming and saying that we need funds to research this phenomena that actually might happen in the future, and that the North Pole might melt and the sea levels would go up and Maldives would disappear and so forth and so on, you know. And everybody said, somebody said yes, most people said yeah, and all that sort of thing. And 1998 was actually the year of innocence. And strange things started happening in 1998, not in the city so much as in little outlying islands, basically coral islands in the Indian Ocean. Every 4 years, there used to be a current that used to go through the Indian Ocean called the El Nino. And the current used to come and go and make little differences, but not anything drastic. In 1998, because of aggravations of human, basically of human origins, El Nino as a current went up by 3 degrees in terms of heat, and it usually used to come in summer. And one would think that 3 degrees of heat in terms of latitude would be not such a lot for a large ocean like the Indian Ocean. And it didn't affect the ocean at large, but what it did affect was every single coral island on the ocean. And if you look at the Indian Ocean carefully, you'll find that almost 60% of the world's coral outside of Australia and Belize actually is concentrated in the Asian area, in the Indian Ocean and off the African coast. And coral is a very funny thing. It's the thermometer of the sea. It gives you the health of the oceans. So if the coral is healthy, and the coral is fine, then more or less the ocean is healthy and the ocean is fine, because the coral actually finally specializes itself in two areas which is very, very sensitive. It's so sensitive, as a matter of fact, that most of the time when we are diving, we're told not to touch the coral even gently, because what you tend to do is you exude certain moistures and oils which are toxic from your body, because you're constantly throwing out toxins from your body from various ways. And one of them happens to be sweat, and also through your skin. And those toxins actually affect the coral. It doesn't die immediately, but within a month or 2 months, if you touch your coral, it sometimes shows symptoms of that touch, because it starts, that those areas start bleaching, which you actually touch. If you monitor the coral very carefully and you bring fronds of coral which you actually touch with your bare hand, you'll find that it'll actually, after a month or so, parts of it will start bleaching and getting white, which means that bleaching of coral is a symptom of illness, because coral is living. It's a living creature. It's made up of many, many, many little creatures that live in the coral and grow and breed, and when they crossbreed, and their breeding is almost like plants, which is that they fly this cloudy kind of sperm into the water once or twice a year, which then floats off in the currents and cross-pollinates with other corals and makes corals grow in areas which are not growing, or the existing coral that is there already becomes even healthier and goes further. So coral tends to grow on other coral, which is dead coral. So it keeps growing in layers. And over a period of time, the growth of coral breaks out of the surface of the ocean and forms little islands, like the Maldives. Maldives are pure coral islands which are based on a mountain range which is submerged and which had coral growing on it and grew and grew and grew and grew and broke out of the thing. And it had a fringing reef to protect the main coral area, so from monsoon and from currents. And so you get what is called a lagoon. So if the lagoon is as big as my hat, the island is as big as a 1 rupee coin in the middle somewhere, which is usually on one end of the fringing reef because it faces the monsoon. So it protects the island from the westerly monsoons, so that usually on the eastern side of the island you get a drop off which goes all the way down, and on the western side you get a huge lagoon with a fringing reef on it. We started diving in Lakshadweep in 1995, and it was pristine. It had never been, nobody had ever seen it before, except parts of the Indian Navy, who had dived purely for combat reasons. And it was a chain of islands which is actually an extension of the Maldives. So whereas the Maldives were very heavily dived and extremely heavily developed tourism wise and sometimes very beautifully, the Lakshadweep islands were actually not inhabited like the Maldivian islands. They were habited with very small populations. There was a population of 50,000 people spread between 28 islands. So they were uninhabited islands, but there were also large amounts of habited islands where people were staying. And the habitation was depending on how much groundwater you got in each island. So the amount of groundwater that could be collected, harvested, or that actually percolated into their wells was the sustainability of those islands. So the populations grew or diminished or migrated depending on drinking water, because nothing else grew on the islands except man-made palm trees. All natural vegetation had been cut, and coconut palms had been planted by men because in their great wisdom they realized that they would have to be harvested only twice a year. So for the rest of the year they just hung about waiting for the coconuts to ripen, because they didn't do very much about it. It happened by itself. So the islands are covered in coconut trees, and that's their main crop. And their second crop, in some islands where they are not too lazy to go out to sea, is to fish tuna. And because the practices of coral islands are very, very sustainable, you don't use big nets, you don't use huge trawlers, because big nets get caught in the bottom on the coral and get torn, or they wreck the coral, so nobody actually uses them because they're impractical. The fishing practices of islanders, usually in the Maldives and in Lakshadweep, is to do long line fishing, which is rod and line fishing, but not the kind of rod and line fishing that we all are used to, which is with barbed hooks, where you set and you catch one fish and then you wait and then you catch another fish and then you wait and then maybe you don't get a third fish. But here what they do is they've examined the feeding patterns of shoals of tuna. And the way you see shoals of tuna is you can see them from the surface, because you see the birds, the whole flock of birds that will be following the shoals. Because when the shoals of tuna surround small fish like sardines or bait fish, the fish in their frenzy of trying to get away from the tuna actually start jumping out of the water. And so the birds actually swoop down and try and get whatever is left over, whoever survives the tuna. So you'll find a funnel of birds usually following shoals of tuna on the surface. And all feeding is done at the surface. It's never done at depth. What they do is they take shoals of other fish and they herd them to the surface and then surround them and then dive into them and start feeding. And all the little fish start jumping out of the water. And the birds actually come down and start swooping and getting whatever is left over. So everybody shares and shares alike, but you can spot the birds. So you know that there's a shoal of feeding tuna. Now what do? In the mornings when they go out fishing, they catch a whole lot of bait fish from the lagoons. Bait fish are little whitings. They're called whitings. They're about this big. And they're little minnow-like things. but they're fully grown and they're caught in nets and they're held alive in little tanks on the tips of their boats. Then they go out, and when they hit a shoal, a feeding shoal, they wade into this feeding shoal and start chucking bait fish into the water. So even if the shoal does not manage to catch their own fish, they start actually artificially providing them with bait fish to actually get into a frenzy. Now when they get into a feeding frenzy, then they don't actually see what they're eating. Then they eat anything that moves. So when they start chucking all these bait fish in, they start thinking that it's a big shoal of bait fish, and they go into a frenzy. And about six fishermen standing on a little platform like a table, which is attached to the back of the boat, with six rods, with hooks that are not barbed, start fishing without bait. They just put the hooks into the water. So the hooks themselves, because they're alien, they'll bite, because they bite anything at that time, in that feeding frenzy. Now why do they not have barbs? Because each rod has two helpers in the boat, in the back, in the hold, which is to detach the fish and free the rod so that it can be put back into the water and another fish will hold on. So each rod catches approximately 15 fish in a period of 6 minutes. Okay, now if it had a barb, then those guys would be actually busily trying to take the damn barb out because it's stuck in the fish because it won't come out easily. And they would lose time before the shoal disappeared. So the trick was, the timing and the training is, how fast can you free the rod so that it can be put back into the water and another fish is hauled out. So the fisherman's action is just putting the hook into the water and pulling out a fish. And the helper's job is to free the fish and free the rod, because they know that the shoal will last in that feeding frenzy from 2 minutes to 6 minutes, period. And then they all disappear. And then you go looking for another shoal. Sometimes you don't find it. So the efficiency of how fast you can actually turn that rod around is what the catch is actually all about. So it's not that they don't catch a lot of fish. They do. Those six rods can actually catch from anywhere from 100 to 200 fish in from 2 to 6 minutes. But it's a very sustainable practice, because you don't clean out shoals. You don't kill everything in the ocean. You don't, you know, chuck out all the rubbish fish which you don't need and only harvest the fish that you need, because you catch everything like industrial fishing does. Is that they have 20 meter long nets which scrape the bottom of the sea, wreck everything that's there and leave great swaths of deserts, because they take out everything. They take out dolphins, they take out turtles, they take out the works. Small fish, big fish, the whole thing. They pick the fish that they want, and then they chuck the other dead fish back into the water. The funny thing is that usually fish of any kind gets recycled very quickly in the ocean because other fish come and eat it. But here there's nothing left to eat it. So all the dead fish actually rots and doesn't go back into the food chain, because you've caught everything in the ocean from that 20 meters or 20 kilometer swath. So there's nothing left to eat the fish, which is the stuff that you've thrown back into the ocean. So it's a really, really desperately wasteful way of actually fishing, which most nations like Japan and Russia, to a very large extent, and even the West, actually practices in the open ocean. Now, one of the reasons they can't do that in near coral islands is because the coral islands have lots of little corals, which in the old days were called the fangs of the ocean. I mean, we find that very pretty today, and we go down there and have a look at the color of the coral and things, but coral has always been a sailor's nightmare, because most of them grow all the time, so they can't be charted, and you never know which one has grown and which one hasn't, and you might think that there's nothing there, and you'll be your bottom will get ripped open on a shoal, especially fringing reefs, which sometimes don't give you any warning at all, because at high tide they're all submerged. And it's only on low tide that you actually manage to see the tips of the fringing reef. Otherwise it doesn't look like a reef at all. It looks like normal ocean. You might just get your bottom ripped out. And sometimes they're not on the charts because they haven't been explored. So they protect not only the islands, but they also, to a very large extent, protect the fishing grounds around the island from netting. So, because not because the islanders are particularly responsible, or they are educated, or they are thinking consciously of the fact that if we sustainably fish, then many generations will be able to fish. They don't think of all that. That's the only way they know, because that's the only way they've been taught, and it's come down from generation to generation, and it's the most practical way to catch the fish. And what do they do with the excess fish that they catch? Now, there are 50,000 islanders, so obviously only about 1,000 of them go fishing. So whatever fish they catch, they actually sell to the other islanders. And whatever surpluses they catch sometimes in seasons like in winter, where the seas are calm and there's a lot of very good fishing, some of the fishermen migrate to some non-habited islands where there's lots of concentrations of tuna. And they fish large quantities and store them. What do they do with the fish? Because there's no freezing process, there are no motherships, there's no processing plants, there's no nothing to do with the excess fish. So they actually, they smoke them. They harvest the fish, they cut off the bones, they fillet the fish, they soak them in seawater, they boil them in seawater, and they hang them out to dry, and they use coconut palms to dry the fish into little bricklets. And those fish are then stored for the whole year, and during the monsoons when they don't have fish, they actually take shavings of them, put them into rice, make a kind of khichdi, and eat it. And whatever surpluses that they have, they take it to the mainland and sell it, because the Maldives also sells, it does exactly precisely the same thing with their fish. And they sell it to Sri Lanka, they sell it to a whole lot of other nations that actually traditionally have eaten dried fish. But this is a special dried fish, it's a smoked dried fish. So its flavor is full, it's a smokiness to it, there is a, it's a great delicacy, but we don't know that because it looks like shit. But the Japanese have actually managed to get really good smoked mas. It's called mas min. Min in Malayali means fish, and mas means meat actually. So tuna for the Maldivians and the Lakshadweepians is actually chickens of the sea, because it's not white meat. It's a combination of white and red meat. And it's not fishy at all. It's not like, doesn't taste like fish, it tastes like meat. Especially skipjack, which is the small tuna, which they catch most of the time. Now, they've had this tradition for hundreds of years. It hasn't changed. They've tried, people have tried to bring in fishing nets into the islands. The government has tried to bring in ships with fishing nets to help the islanders increase their catch and therefore their incomes and stuff like that. Thank God, most of it has failed. The Maldivians, on the other hand, a very smart little government, because Maldivians are exactly like the Lakshadweepians, who are illiterate, lazy, don't care a shit, don't want to do anything. But there, a couple of educated guys got together and decided to make it into a tourist paradise. And how would they make it into a tourist paradise? They decided that the only real thing that they had was what nature had given them, which was lots of fish, lots of very beautiful coral islands, and lots of coral islands. And they have atolls. They have in each lagoon, they have 3 or 4 atolls, which is little islands sticking out. And the huge lagoons that they have. And they developed some of the islands, left the islands alone, and they did not allow commercial fishing, because they found that the income from commercial fishing was a minuscule of what they were getting through tourism by letting people come and see what they have. And because the waters were so clear, your visibility was 150 feet in any direction. So if you looked over the edge of the pool with a mask on, I mean of the boat, you'd get vertigo. Because especially if you were at the edge of a wall, we just went off into 150 meters down into inky blue, and you could see all the way down, actually. I mean, it's that clear. It's unbelievable. You know, on a, like they say, on a clear day you could see forever. That's Lakshadweep and Maldives. It's such clear, pure waters. So they realized that because they had a very small population, and because they had many, many islands, they could afford to actually ban all forms of commercial fishing on those islands, completely on their territorial waters, allow the islands to sustain themselves the way they wanted to, and grow. Now, you think that the Maldives had the perfect answer to any kind of global warming or any kind of dicking around with nature. It's not true. Because what people were doing in Europe and what people were doing in the North Pole actually affected the islands in the Indian Ocean. Because what happened to El Nino in 1998 wasn't what people in the Indian Ocean were doing to make it react the way it did. What actually the El Nino did was, it was a cumulative impact of what the rest of the world was doing for its water temperatures to go up by 3 degrees. When the water temperatures went up by 3 degrees, guess what happened? 90% of all coral cover in the Indian Ocean died. It died in 2 months flat. It was like a desert. It was decimated. Now, coral islands sustain an entire eco-lifestyle of their own, which is called the coral fish. And they're very specific. They're not deep water fish. They're fish that actually live and survive and are territorial and stay on coral islands. And therefore, there's a balance between the so-called herbivores and the so-called carnivores. And the balance is always about 50-50. So you have fish that actually are predators, and you have fish that actually feed off plankton and various other vegetation, and they're divided 50-50 because they live off each other. So the film that we made was unfortunately in hindsight, because we didn't know what was happening. And therefore, only after the impact of El Nino, that we closed shop for the season, because we closed shop during the monsoons, and we closed shop in May and came back in October. And in that time, our world had changed. Our underwater world had changed completely. The sea was devastated. And we were wondering why, and then we went back and started thinking in hindsight as to what were the symptoms. Did they give us a warning? Did this phenomena tell us in advance that it was going to happen? And what were the various symptoms? And there were. But because they were unprecedented, we did not actually join 2 and 2 and make 22. We were trying to make 4. And no solutions happened with 2 and 2 making 4. Because that's too simple. All solutions in the world, creative, scientific or otherwise, unfortunately, the real breakthroughs are when 2 and 2 make 22. And that is when, which is what you have to look for. So any people doing research, any people doing any creative endeavor whatsoever, if you are happy with 4, you're mediocre. You'll never get the answers that you need. So you have to eventually aim for 22, otherwise you're not even going to get there. Because even the client and his wife can get up to 4. So why should they pay you obscene amounts of money to go out into this world and turn around and say, I'm an IIT graduate and I want to be paid X amount of money to survive so that I can actually break through creative and industrial and sustainable and natural products which will change the way we live. Because if you're not aiming for 22, you're not going to get there. So we didn't add up 2 and 2 to 22 because we really didn't know what we were looking for. And there were symptoms, because what happened at that time was when we were diving in before May, sometime around January, February, we had an epidemic of a creature called the crown of thorns. Now the crown of thorns is a kind of a starfish which is very bright, very ugly, extremely dangerous looking thing. It's a purple fish with black markings and little things sticking out of it, which we didn't realize were poisonous because we never used to touch them. But when thousands of them appeared from nowhere and started eating up the coral, they're coral eaters. So they cluster around the base of all the coral at the roots and start eating them from the roots, and then the coral bleach and topple over, and then they eat them completely, but usually we used to find them in about one in 100 square meters. You know, when we were doing dissections and we were looking for them. But they're there, but they're never there in the kind of numbers. Now we started getting 10 of them in each coral front at the bottom. You'd find them all there. They were just carpeting the whole area. They were like exploding at a great level, and we just couldn't contain them. We couldn't figure out why. Went on the net, went to Google, went to Australia, asked the ocean, what do you call, scientific research people in Australia, what the hell is this? And they came back with relatively incomplete answers themselves. And they said, well, it's a phenomena that happens occasionally. They also die by themselves. Said, but if you want to do something about them, don't touch them, because every time you kill a crown of thorns artificially by stabbing it or harpooning it or knifing it, it releases 1,000 eggs. So every time you killed one, you actually spawned 1,000. So finally they got back to us after about 1 month of fiddling around themselves and said the only way to kill a crown of thorns without it releasing its eggs was to give it a saline injection in the heart. Which we did, because the heart was in the center, we assumed, because it was a round thing with little things sticking out of it, that the heart would be dead center. So we took a large injection and filled it with saline water from the sea, or sea water, and stabbed it in the center and injected it. And it worked. But when in the process of picking them up and taking them to shore and burning them, which is what we were advised to do, it was ineffectual, frankly. I mean, there were so many of them that we just couldn't manage, because there were just four instructors on the island, and all the diving students that were there, which were 10 or 15 at a time, were doing nothing except trying to kill crown of thorns. You know, I mean, it was like this completely futile thing. So after a while, everybody gave up, because every time you touch these damn things, you'd get an itch, you'd get some kind of abrasion, you'd get, you know, your hands would swell up, all kinds of things would happen. So we were hoping that it would then go away by the end of the monsoons, and they did. When we came back, after all the coral had died, so had they. But somewhere in nature, there was this need to go into a feeding frenzy, because they knew the coral was going to die, which we never added up to 22. Because when you found a phenomenon like that, which suddenly was completely unexplained, and thousands of crown of thorns were hanging around, it should have struck us that they're on a suicide mission. And that obviously they're spawning because something is triggered off the spawn. And something that's triggered off the spawn is a foreknowledge that there's going to be a disaster, that all the coral are going to die, all the food is going to die. And if all the food is going to die, they're going to die. And therefore, they just multiplied like hell and ate up everything in the occasion that even when the coral died, some of them would survive, so that they could come back, not in the numbers that they were, but under the normal circumstances of what they existed as, when there was no danger to the coral. So when you look at symptoms of nature, when you see man-made disasters of a huge kind, of deforestation, of animals, of them being dehoused, of tigers' habitats disappearing, everything. There is always a symptom, if you look for it, of a disaster that is about to happen. So, because we do not know, does not excuse us from not wanting to. And the fact is that in nature, there is nothing that happens which is not forewarned. Therefore, because the survival of the species, for whatever the species might be, is so importantly built into the DNA of a natural phenomena, that every creature living is given a forewarning to try and save itself from an unnatural happening. When the tsunami hit the Andamans, all the tribals knew that the tsunami was going to come. All the Nicobarians were behaving in an abnormal manner. And because they were so close to them, And because they were so observant about them, they realized that something is going to happen, and they added 2 and 2 and made 22 and said, run for the hills, because that's what the animals are doing. And though it didn't help, because the hills were not that high, that the tsunami didn't go over them. But they did, but the surviving tribals all survived because they climbed the trees and hung on. Those are the only ones who survived, especially in the greater Andamans. Because the wave was 30 foot high and swamped everything. So hills, plains, everything was underwater. And the only, when 3 days later when the rescue teams did go in and managed to, the only survivors that they found were the ones that had climbed the trees and were hanging on. Now, how did they know that they should do that? Because there was no time to do that when the tsunami hit you. There was no time to start running off to the hills and start climbing trees. Because the wave came and just washed you away, that was it. That's what happened in Thailand. Killed hundreds and thousands of tourists because everybody stood on the beach to see, shoot, what's this? I mean, that's actually what happened. Because the sea took a big sigh, it pulled out, pulled out, pulled out, pulled out, pulled out, kept pulling out for a mile. And you could see the bottom of the sea. And everybody came running to the edge to see, shit, what's going on? And then it came back and just killed everybody, obviously. Whereas the tribals in the Andamans did exactly the opposite. They ran in the opposite direction. And they ran for any high ground. And they climbed any tree that they could find. So, everything has a forewarning. So whatever we set for ourselves, whatever disasters that we create, through greed, through lack of information, through insensitivity, through trying to create huge surpluses and try and make money off it, for whatever it's worth. Because all our economic laws don't talk about sustainability, they talk about profit. And you can only get profit if you create excess. So if you need to drink one glass of water every 3 hours, and therefore a certain amount of water to drink to survive, then you create huge excesses and bottle that water and sell it to guys who can't do it. And with that trade, you can either trade it or you can sell it for currency. You then buy certain creature comforts for yourself. And therefore the cycle goes on by the whole business of creating excesses. We have to start re-looking at the way we live. Because if all of us are going to get into the creation of extra to be able to become rich and afford other creature comforts, then it has to be that less people are rich and more people are poor. Because if everybody got rich, then nobody would buy the excess product that you actually made. So the law of economics is that there'll always have to be very few people who are rich and lots of people who are poor to be able to make the people who are rich sustain themselves. So when you try equality of any kind, it doesn't work, it always boomerangs, because that's the way it is. And you cannot become rich totally unless you create huge surpluses to be able to trade to people who don't have them. Now it looks very simplistic, but I'm sure there are much more complex things to it. But if you read Keynes, for instance, and his economic philosophy, you'll realize it's all about surpluses. Now when surpluses go out of control and you start mining the earth, you start logging it, you start killing everything else in it to be able to create those surpluses which are not sustainable, which is what sustainability is all about, then you find that even within sustainability, there's a time limit to it. So when you cut a forest and you start growing grain in that land, which grew trees, it has a life of a certain number of years where you can grow the grain before it becomes completely juiced out and becomes useless and becomes a desert. When it becomes a desert, what do? Because there's lots of other forest land around, and you don't think that the tigers and the elephants and the birds and the bees actually need that land as much as you do to create your own surpluses. You abandon the desert and you go on and cut some more forest. At least that's what the practice has been so far. and you keep leaving behind you desert. Now usually what happens is, somewhere along the line there was justice in it, because man has only managed to destroy. Whenever they've tried to resurrect forests by planting them again or doing fiddling around and doing whatever they did, it was pathetic because it never really worked. And it only worked when we abandoned it and went off and pretended it wasn't our responsibility. And the fact was that the earth itself put into a crash program of resurrection to repair itself. And as long as it's capable of repairing itself, it will repair itself. So when you turn around and say, how do you undo the damage that you've done? Please don't undo the damage that you've done. Just leave it to nature to do it, because nature is best equipped to do it itself. But don't fiddle with it. Don't try and improve on it, because you can't. So what happened on this island was a very small laboratory of the lessons that we learned, which was that there's always a symptom, there's always a forewarning, except that you're not equipped, or you're not sensitive, or you're not natural enough, or you're not close enough to nature to understand it. So like the tsunami, all the people who didn't understand the tsunami and didn't understand nature and and animals died. Some of the people who understood that also died, but a lot of people who understood nature and animals and the forewarning that they got survived. So exactly like that, the same thing happened to the island. So we'll have a look at this film, and then if there are any questions, I'll answer them. And the film, remember, is incomplete in a lot of ways because it was in hindsight. We started making the film after the event happened. And we started adding the 2 and 2 into 22 after it actually became obvious. So then we tried to sort of go backwards and try and make sense of the disaster that had actually happened. And the fact is that it's still a secret disaster, because nobody else is bothered. The rest of the world just carried on with their lives as if nothing had happened. And nobody actually took it and said, shit, 1998, when all the scientists and all the say the world is coming to an end kind of shit, and they were all called quacks and idiots and alarmists of various kinds, that it had actually come upon us. And it wasn't until 2005 that you actually saw the beginnings of global warming's impact on climate change, that people actually sat up and said, shit, it's happening. So you had a window period of from 1998 to 2006 to actually do something about climate change. But nobody bothered. Nobody really bothered, because even us who were sitting on the island, we were busy trying to make this film, you know, in hindsight, you know, sort of couldn't get up to the authorities or to the people who mattered or to world press and say, hey guys, this is just the beginning. This is just the beginning, because these are the most sensitive areas on earth. And that the whole of the earth is going to respond like this, because though they're tougher right now, and even the islands, there were parts of the island which were tougher than other parts of the island. You see, as I told you, there's a western side and there's a leeward side. The leeward side is the eastern side. Why we call it the leeward side is because it's leeward of the monsoons. Now the kind of coral that you have, the species of coral that survive on the western side versus the leeward side, are completely different. There's no commonness in the kind of coral that are on the east, on the western reef, and outside the western reef, and outside the eastern reef. Now all the eastern reef corals were filigree corals. They were delicate tabletops, you know, with long stems, and tabletops which are huge, which are about this big, and they were like little filigree work. And all the corals that were on the western side, which bore the brunt of the monsoons every single year, were hard leaf coral. They were locked into each other, and they were brain coral, which were huge boulders of coral with a brain pattern on them, and they were all kinds of other corals which were much more resilient, the corals on the western side. Now, after El Nino hit and everything died, the eastern side was completely smashed because they had never faced anything like it, because they were always protected from the monsoon by the mass of the island itself. So the leeward side coral was always protected and therefore was far more delicate and very beautiful. And there were rows and rows and rows of it, you could, as far as I could see. All of that toppled and died. On the western side, a lot of the brain coral died. But a lot of the leaf coral actually survived, because that is really tough. But it all survived after 15 to 20 meters. So from the surface to 15 meters, it also died. But because the amount of the water temperature was much cooler at depth, those tough corals on the western side survived. Nothing on the eastern side survived. So it was selective, and it was a process where I do believe that when climate change hits us, it's not that it's going to kill the world, it's not going to be like the dinosaurs disappearing. But sometimes you wish that it was, because it's over when it's over. Here you're going to malinger, because what nature is going to bring back onto you is a very selective cleansing. So the tougher of the species, and of human beings, and of people who live in forests and live close to forests and live without creating too much surplus by stripping everything of whatever it has, they will probably survive. Civilizations that depend on surpluses and on materials and on creature comforts are not going to survive. And unfortunately, everybody in this room forms the latter part of what we call the civilization. So most of the tribal peoples of the world, all our so-called Naxalites which are now running around with guns, okay, they will probably survive. Because for them to live on a daily basis is tough enough today. And they're willing to survive the conditions under which they're living right now, because they're so deprived, then they'll survive it. But all of us who depend on running water and electricity and lifts and, you know, and creature comforts and other people to do all our donkey's work for us, will probably not survive unless you adapt. Some of us will adapt because you have to. A lot of us will not. So the next 20 years or the next 25 years, I believe, is crucial to this planet, because it's going to kill huge amounts of people. And who it's going to kill and who is not going to kill will depend on the people. Now, this film is therefore just a small symptom of what can happen without your doing anything about it. So you can't turn around and say, hey, I'm not creating a carbon footprint, I'm being responsible, I'm doing sustainable whatever the hell you're doing. Why would I sort of, you know, bear the brunt of nature's backlash? Doesn't matter. As far as nature is concerned, you're a global citizen. And anybody on the globe, if you cross the limits of sustainability and of balance and of sense and of greed, then everybody pays the price. And it's not selective. So the islands were living pretty well on their own. They were not interfering in anybody's life. They had no carbon footprint. They were fishing with great sustainability. They were living off whatever they had. There was very little outside help that was coming in. They were very beautiful. They were perfectly balanced. They understood without understanding why they were living in a particular way, because it was tradition more than anything else. But they were hit first, and their lifestyles and their lives were decimated, whereas all the people living in New York and Bombay and Chennai and wherever else we were creating all our carbon footprints actually got away with it. But that was because it was the beginning. Because coral islands, as I said, are like little thermometers stuck all over the world, giving you an idea of what the future is going to be like. Because they're so sensitive that any small change in water temperatures, like even 3 degrees, makes such a huge difference to their lifestyles and their lives. So, what happened? All the fish died. All the herbivores increased in massive quantities. The carnivores either died or disappeared. And fishing catches dropped. So, people who lived off coastal activities, luckily the islanders didn't, because they were lazy little buggers, and they realized a long time ago that the best way to live without having to work is to call the government my bap. And they lay down and said, my bap, what are we going to do? So the government put in a huge rescue package and shipped large amounts of food and fuel and everything to the islanders so that they could survive without having to move an arm. But people who went down to the bottom of the sea realized that everything now that was living on the islands was being sustained artificially. And that if the islanders had to suddenly be cut off on their own and everything broke down, they would not be able to survive a month because the seas were untenable. Because they've been given surpluses to such an extent and with such generosity by nature that they, even when they didn't work, they didn't have to, because they could put an arm out into the water, catch a fish, you know, cook it, break a coconut, take the juice out, cook it, and eat it, and go to sleep. Because it was temperate, it never got hotter than a particular amount. It got hot, it never got colder than a particular amount. And heat never really hit anybody, the cold does. So they could run around in one lungi and, you know, occasionally take it off and wash it furtively so that they would never look at them, or wash it in part. You know how ladies bathe and wash their clothes simultaneously in the open? They wash a part of the sari, then they wrap it around, and then they open up the other part, and then they wash it so that they don't have to take it completely off. So they do it like that, and they can do that. You can survive on one lungi. So the government had to put in a program to actually save the islanders from themselves. But all they were asking the question was, what did we do? And they didn't. They didn't do a damn thing. So let's see what the film has to say. But remember, the film is not absolute and complete, because all the arguments that we got, all the rationals that we got for it were in hindsight. And we didn't have the sense to capture it while it was happening, because it happened while we were away. Because we left the islands by that time, when this whole disaster took place, and we came back to the disaster and then started working backwards. And how we shot the healthy islands was that the islands we realized that were completely remote and were off the El Nino so-called direct path actually weren't touched. So we had to go to very far off islands which were uninhabited to shoot them, to show you how the islands looked before El Nino. And of course, shot the islands the way they looked with El Nino. So, and how after 10 years, how nature corrected itself and how it went back onto the path of recovery as long as El Nino didn't hit us again. So every year when we close the school, the diving school in May, and we come back in October, we dread to see whether the water temperatures have fluctuated too much, because whatever has grown back will also die. So let's see.
Base, this luminous orb that we call Earth has an uncanny resemblance to a living cell. A magnificent metaphor for the oneness of all creation, reminding man of his inextricable links with all living things in the single resonant being that we call life. Just as in a living cell, two-thirds of the Earth's surface is made up of water. And it is here, beneath the relentless swell and surge of the oceans where the sun's light filters through, that life first burst forth. Several millions of years ago, minute organisms discovered that they could transform the sun's energy into food. this was the beginning of the coral reef and a veritable explosion of life was to follow. A bold extravaganza of color and form, an exuberant multiplication of species coexisting in an elaborate tapestry of interactions and interdependencies that make the reef one of the most vibrant and life-enriching ecosystems of our planet. This is the story of the atoll reefs of the Lakshadweep Islands in the Indian Ocean. Among the least explored reefs in the world, these idyllic atolls are today being affected by a problem created very far from their shores. Amidst the meadows of seagrass, baby fish and other sea animals bide their time till they are old enough to take their chances in the hustle and bustle of the coral reef. Here, in the reef just a few meters underwater, there is sunlight in plenty. For coral, this is prime real estate. Corals have formed a unique alliance with microscopic algae that live within the reef. The algae use sunlight in a process called photosynthesis to make food for themselves and also provide well over 90% of the coral's diet. Freed of the need to find its own food, the coral diverts its energies to building the calcium carbonate skeleton that eventually becomes the reef, the home of the algae. The entire ecosystem of the reef is dependent on this finely balanced symbiosis. The relationship has worked so well for millions of years that today, the reef is the largest living structure found anywhere on Earth and is home to an astonishing number of fish. From the minuscule to the majestic. Metropolis, the competition for space and food is as fierce and relentless as the rise and fall of the tides. The result is the amazing diversity of species that live in our oceans today. Their ingenious strategies for cohabitation ensure not just their own survival, but also the vitality of their environment. Space is at a premium here. The many crevices and ledges formed by centuries of growth by hard coral make perfect resting places for fish and crustaceans. Other coral also make comfortable homes, with some being transformed into sprawling apartment complexes. Often two sets of fish share the same living quarters. Night feeders with their large eyes adapted to the dark, like squirrel fish and the primitive nurse shark. Resting by day, moving out as dusk falls. Competition is a way of life on the reef, especially intense when it comes to food. The need to eat and avoid being eaten has kept the creative juices flowing in both predator and prey. Speed, power, stealth. Have a formidable arsenal to make sure they eat well. But the smaller fish are not without their own strategies for survival, schooling together to confuse and divert. Developing tough armor-like hard shells and spines that in the case of stonefish and lionfish also contain a deadly poison. Herbivores constitute more than 50% of all major fish on the reef. Herbivores like the parrotfish are the reef gardeners, mowing down the algae, maintaining the life-sustaining balance of coral and algae. Eating prodigious amounts through the day, they expel vast amounts too. This is the soft white sand that helps to form the beautiful beaches and eventually the islands. Imagine that. Since time immemorial, the symbiotic relationships and finely balanced interdependencies of the reef and its inhabitants have ensured the health and robustness of this vibrant ecosystem. And so also the health of our world. But 5 years ago, calamity struck the shores of Lakshadweep. In 1998, the El Niño current, a natural phenomenon occurring every 5 to 7 years and raising ocean temperatures by a half to 1 degree Celsius. It raised temperatures by an unprecedented 2 to 5 degrees, causing death and devastation. It was as if the seas had caught fire. Almost all the coral bleached, and in a few months, most of it was dead. Once lively reefs turned into coral graveyards. Habitat gone, fish populations plummeted, an ancient ecosystem was crumbling before our eyes. The work of millions of years, undone in a matter of months. The doomsday scenario of marine scientists and conservationists was playing out in the troubled waters of Lakshadweep. And the world sat up and took notice? Alas, no. Even though global warming was seen as the chief cause of the overheated currents, a strictly man-made phenomenon, for most of the world, it was business as usual. Once again, it was up to nature to restore the balance. And almost miraculously, her rescue package is bringing the reefs back to life. With coral destroyed, the algae had gained the upper hand, colonizing every dead frond. The need of the hour was herbivores. Whole armies of them. The sight of all that algae threw them into a frenzy of feeding and multiplying. In many reef believed they now constituted as much as 90% of the fish population. Swarms of surgeons and parrots mowed down the algae, creating conditions for coral to grow again. Several years, if not decades, before they return to their original glory.
As the head of the food chain, man has been constantly abusing his position of power with a reckless disregard for all other species, for the environment, and ultimately even for the consequences to himself. Do you know that coral reefs are the world's largest resource of carbon? The destruction of the coral will not only leave the world immeasurably poorer, but will permanently affect our own lives as well. What can we do to protect the reefs? How can we prevent global warming, that fire-spewing dragon of myth made real by modern man's greed for more and more? Over 150 years ago, a great and wise American Indian chief said of the white man, "For he is a stranger who comes in the night and takes from the land whatever he needs. The earth is not his brother, but his enemy. And when he has conquered it, he moves on. He kidnaps the earth from his children, and he does not care. His appetite will devour the earth and leave behind a desert." We have all been like the white man. But there is another way to be. Every part of this earth is sacred to my people. Every shining pine needle, every sandy shore, every mist in the dark woods, every clearing, every humming insect is holy in the memory and experience of my people. The choice is ours. And we would do well to remember, man did not weave the web of life. He is merely a strand in it. Whatever he does to the web, he does to himself.
Bye.
done.
How do I get a copy of this?
I'll do it. Well, we made this film 5 years after the event actually happened. Luckily, we had footage from before because we were shooting randomly. It wasn't with any intent to make into a documentary. We were just so thrilled to be able to take a camera down with the housing on it that we actually fooled around for a couple of years and got large amounts of footage which we actually managed to salvage and put together again in hindsight, not in the order it was shot, but out of context, but thank God we had it. But as I said, we're back on the island, it's slowly recovering. Every year we go back to the mainland and we come back when you don't know whether you'll find the island still there. So we're living actually on the edge now, because people who were party to this phenomena, including the Crown of Thorns, are just now so aware of every little thing that happens and every little flood that takes place and every little crop failure or every little drought that might happen, that we are now becoming, if nothing else, alarmists, because we are looking and jumping at shadows. But I think it's better to look and jump at shadows than not, frankly. So I don't know how we all can actually contribute towards reversing anything with global warming, but let's start with ourselves. Though it might not eventually, whatever might happen to you, might not be because of what you do. The fact is that if you start with yourself, at least then you can point fingers at everybody else. So pointing fingers is a very big hobby that we all have. But I think for once we should try and justify our pointing fingers by saying, hey, I didn't do it. I was fine. I was responsible. Everybody else doesn't. So now the world is looking to India and China to see whether we can curb our emissions and our carbon emissions. And India and China are pointing fingers back at everybody else and saying, you've done your thing. Now you become rich at the cost of everybody else. Now you're telling us to cut our emissions, so pay us for it. So everybody says, just shut up, you know, just do it. So at the end of the day, regardless of what and how hard we point the finger, let's start with ourselves.